make a vipni, yes. Om Vakratunda Mahakaya Surya Koti Samaprabha Nirvigdham Kurume Deva Sarva Karyeshu Sarvada Saraswati Namastubhyam Varade Kamarupini Vidyarambham Karishyami Siddhir Bhavatame Sada Gurave Sarvalokanam Vishaje Bhavaroginam Nidhaye Sarvavidyanam Yakshina Namurtaye Namaha Ishvaro Guru Ratmeti Murti Bheda Vibhagine Vyomavat Vyakta Dehaya Dakshina Murtaye Namaha Sadashiva Samarambham Shankaracharya Madhyamam Asmadacharya Paryantam Vande Guru Paramparam Guru Brahma Guru Vishnu Guru Devo Maheshwaraha Guru Sakshat Param Brahma Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Om Sahana Vavatu, Sahana Bhunaktu, Sahaviryam Karavavahai, Tejasvinavadhe Tamastama Vidvishavahai, Om Shanta Shanta Shantehe, Adihi Om. Evam cha Vedanta Vakyehi. Sadguru Upadeshena cha.
Sadguru Upadeshena cha.
Sarveshu api bhuteshu.
Sarvepi api bhuteshu.
Yesham Brahma Buddhi Rutpanna Dejivan Muktaha Bhavanti. Yesham Brahma Buddhi Rutpanna Dejivan Muktaha Bhavanti.
Yesham.
What happened?
I'm looking for my script. I'm that's too long to remember and say it.
You can repeat after me.
Okay, go ahead.
What about others?
Okay, now I got it. Yeah, I got it now.
Now, fourth chapter.
Yeah, I have it. Yeah, it's just before Jivan Mukta comes up. Yep.
Okay.
Nano Jivan Muktaha Kaha.
Nano Jivan Muktaha Kaha.
Yatha Dehoham Purushoham Brahmanoham Shudroham Asmi Iti.
Yatha Dehoham Purushoham Brahmanoham Shudroham Asmi Iti.
Drida Nischayas Tatha Nagam Brahmanaha. Na shudraha, na purushaha.
Drudha nishtayaha tata na aham brahmana. Na aham brahmana ha, na shudraha, na purushaha.
Kintu asangaha sachidananda svarupaha prakasha rupaha.
Kintu
asangaha sachidananda svarupaha prakasha rupaha.
Sarvantaryami chidakasha rupaha asmi iti.
Sarvantaryami chidakasha rupaha asmi iti.
Drida nischaya rupa aparoksha jnanavan jivan muktaha.
Drida nischaya rupa aparoksha jnanavan jivan muktaha.
Okay, now you can mute your mic.
Okay.
This was the last sentence that we discussed in the previous class. And this sentence describes a Jivan Muktaha, describes a Jnani. Who is a Jnani? Jnanam Asya Asti Iti Jnani. The one who has Jnanam is a Jnani. Jnanam is also an understanding, like any other knowledge. Adhyatmika Jnanam, it is also an understanding. What understanding one had previously, it goes away in the wake of knowledge of one's real Svarupa. So, this jnanam is also an understanding. That is why shastrams should be studied. If this is not a knowledge like any jnanam which removes ignorance, then we did not study the shastra. Why shastrams should be studied? Because shastram gives me knowledge, and the knowledge removes the ajnanam. Therefore, this jnanam is also an understanding. And here, the description of Jivan Muktaha is given only to understand the nature of this knowledge. For what? For one's own understanding. A Jivan Muktaha, otherwise called Jnani, otherwise called Stita Prajnaha, he has the knowledge. What knowledge? He has the opposite knowledge. Virodha Jnanam. Virodha Jnanam means Jnanam which is opposed to Ajnanam. Dehoham, Purushoham, Brahmanoham, Shudroham. This is Ajnanam. This is what an Ajnani has with regard to oneself. This is what an Ajnani thinks. Devokam, Purushokam, Brahmanokam, Shudrokam, Asmi iti. Whereas the Virodha Jnanam is Aham Asangaha, Aham Satchidananda Svarupaha, Aham Prakasha Rupaha, Aham Sarvantaryami, Aham Chidakasha Rupaha, Asmi iti. Every word we have seen. Every word is significant. Each word of the description of Jivan Mukta is important. Each word is significant because each word, it removes the viparita bhavana, the opposite, the conclusions, what one has about oneself. So each word, different words are used, and each word, it is used to negate the different things, the different ideas, what one has about oneself. Dehoham, I am the body, it is negated by the knowledge. Aham asangaha, asanga atma. As atma, I am not associated. I am not associated with anything. I am not dependent on anything, but everything depends on me, the atma. An atma is not touched by anything. That is what asangaha means. But the same Atma, it supports everything, like Akasha. Akasha is not touched by anything. It is not, it can't be polluted by anything. Atma is also like Akasha, Akashavata, untouched, Asangaha. And Degoham, Aham Degaha, it is negated by the knowledge, Aham Asangaha. So Degoham is negated by Asangoham. Then the word Satchit Ananda Swarupaha. That word signifies that Atma is Satyam, Jnanam, Anandaha. Satyam is Sat. Trikale api yat tishtati tat sat. This we have seen. Sat is non-negatable. That which is non-negatable in all the three periods of time. That is sat. Chit means consciousness. Jnanasvarupaha. The knowledge. That which is in the form of knowledge. Consciousness. Anandaha. Anandaha means anantaha. Anantaha. That is infinite. Unlimited. That which is unlimited, which means fullness, completeness, purnatva. So Satchit Ananda Swarupaha. Aham Sat Swarupaha. I am the one because of which everything has its existence. Everything has existence because of me. Me alone. Therefore, Aham Sat Swarupaha. Aham na brahmanaha, kintu aham chitswarupaha. Aham na shudraha, kintu aham anandaswarupaha. Aham na bandaha, aham kintu aham nityamuktaha. Aham na ajnani, kintu aham jnanavan, prakashaswarupaha. I am in the form of the light of consciousness. Aham prakashaswarupa chaitanya. I am the self effulgent being. And this Aham is Svatasiddhaha, Tasmat Prakasha Swarupaha, Jyotisham Api Jyotihi. It is Aham is, you don't need any knowledge to know that Aham. Aham is there. Aham is established, need not be established by any other external thing. Aham, in every cognition, Aham is there. Therefore, it is self-effulgent. Prakashaswarupaha, self-evident. And I am not confined to this body-mind-sense complex. Therefore, Aham Antaryami. I am not confined. Kintu Aham Antaryami. I am the indweller of all the beings. Sarva Bhuteshu Gudatma. Aham Jagat Karanam. I am the cause of this Jagat. As a karanam pervades through the karyam. A cause pervades through the effect. As karanam, I am antaryami of everything. And also there is no inside or outside of me. Agam jagataka sarvantaryami. At the same time, I am not inside or outside of this body. Aham Chidakasha Swarupaha, that in the form of consciousness like space, like Akasha, I am all pervasive. And this jnanam, this knowledge, which is well entrenched, Drida Nishtaiha, in whom he is called Jivan Muktaha. One who has this Drida Nishtaiha Rupa Aproksha Jnanam, Drida Nishtaiha Rupa Aproksha Jnanavan, he is a Jivan Muktaha. Saga Jivan Muktaha. Drida Nishtaiha Rupa Aproksha Jnanavan Jivan Muktaha. And what is Aproksha Jnanam? We were discussing this in the previous class. Aproksha Jnanam. Jnanam, that is knowledge which is direct. That is called Aproksha Jnanam. When you say Aham, I am, it is not available for Pratyaksham nor Aproksham. I am neither available for Pratyaksham nor paroksham. What is pratyaksham? Pratyaksha jnanam is a jnanam which is gained through senses. Akshnaha prati pratyakshaha. And when the object doesn't fall within the range of our senses, it is called aparoksha, it is called paroksha jnanam. Paroksha jnanam. Akshnaha paraha paroksha. Akshnaha prati pratyakshaha. Akshnaha paraha paroksham. Whereas I am, aham is neither pratyaksham nor aparoksham. Not paroksham, not aparoksham, not paroksham. I am neither pratyaksham nor paroksham. And jnanam of myself is aparoksham, aparoksha jnanam. Aparoksha jnanam is a knowledge which is immediate and therefore it is a matter of understanding. Because the knowledge which is gained here, the jnana palam also is here only. The jnana palam need not be enjoyed after death. It is here. Therefore, it is immediate, aparoksha jnana. The one who has this immediate knowledge of oneself is aparoksha jnanavan. What knowledge? The knowledge that I am satyam jnanam anantam brahma. That is aparoksha jnanam. Atma is always aparoksham. Aham brahma atma is always aham atma, it is aparoksham. That brahma, aham brahma, that for that we need Veda as a pramana. Veda is a pramanam for that jnanam. Veda is a pramanam for this aparoksha jnanam. Aham brahma atma. Agar jagat karanam brahma aham asmi. For that Veda is the pramana. So Veda is the pramanam for this aparoksha jnanam, and Veda is also the pramanam for paroksha jnanam. How? Vedanta, that is the last portion of the Veda, is the pramanam for paroksha jnanam, and the first portion of the Veda, that is Veda Purva, it talks about various karma and the various karma pala. For example, swarga, etc. So, swarga and all, that karma pala which are enjoyed in swarga, that is in the other loka, they are all paroksha jnana. So, because it is paroksham, because swarga, etc., all these are paroksham, they can be belief. They can be belief subject to verification. And Veda being a pramanam, we can believe in it. There is nothing harm in it. The knowledge that swarga, swargaha asti, swargaha asti, without knowing what it is, even the knowledge what we have regarding swarga is only based on the description given in the Veda. Therefore, the knowledge of swarga is also pramana praptam, and therefore it is paroksha jnanam. Veda as a pramanam, it tells swargaha asti, and therefore it is paroksham. Because we don't see it, it is not available for pratyaksham. This knowledge is different from the knowledge which are gained through anumana pramana. Swargaha asti, it is not anumana prapta. It is only shastra prapta, Veda prapta. Parvataha vandiman dhumavatvat. You say mountain is on fire. How do you know? Based on the inference, based on the anumana pramana. You see the smoke, therefore you infer the mountain is on fire. So here the pratyaksham is smoke. Smoke is a pratyaksham. The inference that mountain is on fire, it is based on pratyaksha jnanam of smoke. Parvataha vandiman. Why? Dhumavatvat. Because you see the smoke, therefore you infer fire. Therefore it is verifiable. But in the case of swarga, it is not like that. Swarga is not verifiable. The fire what you inferred, it is verifiable. You can go to the top of the mountain and verify it. Whereas swarga, it is purely a belief. But because it is told by the Veda, and as we are giving the status of pramanam to Veda, we call it paroksha jnanam. How do you verify whether swarga is there? to verify whether it is true, one has to give up the body and go and verify. And that what we call it as nitya paroksham. So that as nitya paroksham. It always be paroksham. It can never become protection. Like the Parvataha Vandima. It can never become protection. It is not subject to verification. Therefore, what is required is only Shraddha in what Veda says. Svartaha asti. We believe. Because Veda being a Pramanam, therefore we believe that Svartaha asti. It is a Shraddha. But when we say Jagat Karanam Brahma Ishvaraha asti, here the creator of this Jagat is there, it is not Nitya Paroksham. It is not Nitya Paroksham. It is also Shraddha. Even if you call it Jnanam, it is only a Shraddha. Shraddha in Svarga can be verified only when you go to Svarga, but Shraddha in Brahman, Jagat Karanam Brahma Ishvaraha Agamasmi Iti Jnanam, that Shraddha in self-revealing Atma, that Shraddha in this knowledge, what will happen? It will result as in inquiry and discovery. Therefore, Shraddha in knowing that Agam Jagat Karanam Brahma, Jagat Karanam Brahma Asti, that Shraddha is different from the Shraddha what we have with regard to Svarga. It is not the same Shraddha. The Shraddha in accepting that Jagat Karanam Ishvaraha Asti, that will help in inquiry, further inquiry into ourselves. Therefore, that Shraddha is different from the Shraddha what we talked about with regard to Svarga. If you say Brahma Asti, Brahman is there, it is Paroksha Jnanam. But when you say Brahma Asmi, Tad Brahma Agam Asmi, then it is Aparoksha Jnanam. Brahman is not something independent of Atma. Brahman is not something independent of Atma. Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma is Atma. And Atma is self-revealing, self-evident. And that Atma is Brahma. Therefore, Atma being Satyam Jnanam Anantam Brahma, it cannot be a samsari. It cannot be a samsari. And that knowledge of Atma is Nitya Paroksham. And that Atma is Brahma is Shastra Pramana Praptu. That can be gained only through the Shastra. Therefore, that Brahma is myself. It is direct knowledge. It is direct and immediate knowledge. It is Aparoksha. Therefore, there is no indirect knowledge. There is no indirect knowledge. It is direct knowledge. It is aparoksham. Even when you say agam samsari, that knowledge is also aparoksham. Even though the knowledge is wrong, even though the knowledge that the conclusion with regard to yourself is wrong, but still it is aparoksham. Why? Because Atma is directly experienced by you. In every perception there is Atma. In fact, in the presence of Atma only all perceptions are possible. Therefore, even with regard to the confused knowledge of Atma being samsari, that knowledge is direct knowledge only. It is direct knowledge, but it is a wrong conclusion. That knowledge which came because of a wrong conclusion. Whereas for a Jivan Mukta, this knowledge, the knowledge that Agam Brahma Asmi, it is Aparoksham. And therefore, Aparoksham Jnanavan Jivan Muktaha. That is, a Jivan Mukta becomes liberated while living after having gained this Aparoksha Jnanam. When a Jivan Mukta discovers that Agam Satchit Anandaha, then he becomes liberated, he becomes free while living. It doesn't mean his body will disappear. He discovers that in spite of having this body-mind sense complex, he is free. nothing can bind him. This body, mind, senses, they are only the instruments. They cannot bind the Atma, Nitya Mukta Atma. But they are considered to be the causes of bondage. Why? Because as there is a wrong conclusion based on experiences. And when all the experiences are negated in the wake of Jnanam, the same body, mind, sense complex, which were considered to be the source of bondage, and now it becomes a luxury for Jivan Mukta. This is the difference between a Jnani and an Ajnani. With body, mind, sense complex, we suffer most of the time. Whereas for a Jnani, it is a luxury. With or without, it is free. He knows that he is Brahman in the form of body, mind, sense complex. And they don't limit him. When the pot is told that you are clay, the pot doesn't disappear. The pot enjoys its original nature, that being clay. If the pot wants to become clay, then the pot has got some serious problem. Pot is clay. It has, in fact, the pot is clay only. It has not become pot at all. And it cannot become. If pot realizes that I have not become pot, if I have not become pot, then how can I become clay? Therefore, the whole idea is that you have not become pot. Therefore, the pot should be told, you don't need to become clay. No becoming business. You are already clay. But I am a pot. How? The pot can ask. That is because of Maya. With Maya Upadhi, you become as though a pot. And when you become a pot, you have got some utilities. You can hold water and other utilities are there. Therefore, a pot which enjoys being a pot, but at the same time knows that I am clay, then the pot is a Jivan Mukta, Jivan Mukta Ghata. Similarly, a Jiva also, he becomes free while living. With or without body, mind, sense complex, he is free. The body, mind, sense is not going to bind him. And this freedom is available right now, here itself. When you expose yourself to the Shastra Pramanam, the Shastram which gives knowledge, and the knowledge knocks off the ignorance, and the nature of yourself is revealed, and you being Atma, you become free. You are already free. And discovery of this, so one's Swarupa, that is what makes one free. And that is, and that you can see in Jivan Muktaha, based on the conclusion of Jivan Muktaha, Aham Asangaha Sachidananda Swarupaha Iti. Therefore, Jivan Mukti is possible only when there is Advaitam Brahma. Aham Brahma Asmi. I am not separate from Brahma, Ishvara. Now, after this discussion, the author, he wants to elaborate the topic of Jivan Mukti through the topic of karma. The connection is Jivan Mukti Palam, by connecting Palam to Karma Moksha, that is freedom from the hold of karma. That is the topic which author is going to take up. So you can repeat after me. Brahmai Vagam Asmi Iti.
Brahmai Vivagam Asmi.
Brahma Vivagam Na. It is Brahma Eva Agam Asmi Iti. Brahmai Vagam Asmi Iti.
Brahmai Vagam Asmi Iti.
अपरोक्ष ज्ञानेन निखिल कर्म बंध विनिर्मुक्त स्यात्
ब्रह्मैवाहमस्मीत्य परोक्ष ज्ञानेन अखिल कर्म ग्रन्थ विनिर्मुक्तः स्यात्.
Now we will discuss the sentence. You can mute your mic. By aparoksha jnanam, that is by immediate knowledge that agam brahma asmi, one becomes free from the bondage of all karmas. That is what the meaning. Aparoksha jnanena, what aparoksha jnanam? Agam brahma eva asmi iti. That jnanam, aparoksha jnanam. By that knowledge, nikila karma bandha vinirmuktah syat. He becomes free from the bondage of nikila, all karma. Nikila karma, all karma. One becomes free from the bondage of. This sentence seems to be a simpler sentence, but a lot of things is conveyed through this sentence. We have to analyze this sentence. Brahma eva agam asmi iti aparoksha jnanam. That is, by the immediate knowledge, agam brahma iti, by that knowledge, nikila karma bandha vinirmuktah syat. He becomes free from the hold of all karma. Nikila karma. Vinirmuktah means free. He becomes free. Jivan muktah, vinirmuktah. Who becomes free? Jivan muktah. That we have to supply. Jivan muktah, nikila karma bandha vinirmuktah syat. How? Katam? Brahma eva agam asmi iti jnanena, aparoksha jnanena. Here, the word karma, it has a technical meaning. It doesn't mean just action. We'll be seeing that later. That karma, nikila karma. Vinirmuktaha means freedom. Freedom from karma. Freedom from karma. Freedom from ignorance. Freedom from ajnana. Then a jivanmukta becomes free from ajnana. He becomes free from that which are born of ajnanam also. That is, ajnana karyat api vinirmuktaha syat. When a jivanmukta becomes free from ignorance, ajnanam, he also becomes free from the effect of ajnanam is the karanam for samsara. Ajnana, samsara karanam, ajnanam goes away. Along with that, the product of ajnanam, that also goes away. Ajnana karya tapi vinirmuktah syat. And what are those ajnana karyam? The product of ajnanam. Kartritvam. Kartritvam is one ajnana karyam. It's a product of ajnanam. Kartritvam means the sense of doership. Aham karta iti abhimanam. I am the doer. That conclusion. That is called kartritvam. When kartritvam is there, bhoktritvam also be there. When you have the sense of doership, then you will have the sense of enjoyership. You do something, and the result of that action, who wants to enjoy? You want to enjoy, or somebody wants to enjoy? You want to enjoy. That is why you are doing a certain action. So you become a karta, and you also become a bhokta. So when I am the karta, I am the bhokta, karmapala bhokta. I am the enjoyer of the actions. If my actions are good, then I enjoy good results. If my actions are bad, then I enjoy negative results. Enjoy means experiencing. You experience as you do. As your karma, so will be your karmapala. The experience of the results of action are based on the action. And for the sake of you, somebody cannot enjoy the karma pala. You have done the karma, therefore you have to enjoy the karma pala. You have to undergo the experiences of karma pala. That is the order. And the results of action, the karma palam, they are in the different There are different forms, different types of papa punya. Karma palam is always in the form of papa or punya, and the combination of papa punya. So papa punya is just not just one type of papa punya. There are so many types are there. Papa punya, a lot of present situations are there, which are because of punya, punya pala. Starting from just laugh for a joke, that is also a punya. Enjoying good sleep, that is also a form of the punya. And enjoying comfortable lifestyle, enjoying good food as you like, they are all the manifestation of certain type of punya. Similarly, there are some difficult situations in life, that also the manifestation of certain papa. Even a mosquito bite, that is also a manifestation of certain papa, a karma pala. A jivan mukta is free from all punya papas. He becomes free from all punya papas and he is not responsible anymore for any action. Why? Because since the products of ajnanam also gets destroyed along with ajnanam, in the wake of jnanam, there is no kartrutvam and there is no bhoktrutvam in jivan mukta. He has no sense of doership and he has no sense of enjoyership. And that, therefore, he has no sense of guilt and no sense of hurt. The kartrutvam is the cause for guilt and bhoktrutvam is the cause for hurt. Kimagam sadhuna karavam, kimagam akaravam iti. It comes in Taittiriya Upanishad. Why I have not done like this? Why I did like this? So it's all related to the karma and the karma pala as a bhokta. So for guilt and hurt, what is the cause? That is aham karta aham bhokta, that is the cause. Kartrutvam is the cause for any guilt and bhoktrutvam is the cause for any hurt. This guilt and hurt coming repeatedly is nothing but samsara. That is what is samsara, another definition of samsara. And when you engage in karma, any karma, there is no possibility of avoiding this guilt. Kartratvam, bhoktratvam will be there, and because of that, guilt and hurt will be there. A jivan mukta is free from both. Is free from both because he has no kartratvam and no bhoktratvam. Because he knows himself to be Atma, and Atma is free, and therefore he is free. He is Purnaha. This is the immediate result. The immediate result of knowledge is that he becomes free from the sense of doership and enjoyership. He also becomes free from the karma which he has accumulated over a period of time. All the karma pala which are in his account, from that also, and therefore he becomes liberated, he becomes free. Nothing, no karma can hold him. A jiva, an ordinary jiva, has punarjanma, and therefore he comes and goes because karma is there, and so karma palam in the form of another janma, it comes on and on, and he goes back. So punarapi maranam, punarapi jananam, it goes on and on. And a jiva has gathered countless karmas, not only in this life, but also in the countless previous janma. Therefore, how much karma he will be having, a jiva? How much karma we will be having as a jiva? So all the karma which are standing in our account, they are called karmani. And the author here says, Nikila karma bandha vinir muktaha syat. He is freed from the bondage of all type of karmas. Nikila karma, all forms of karma. The author himself will talk about different forms of karma which binds a jiva. When jnanam is not there, that karma binds a jiva, that the author is going to talk later. But as long as a jiva is under the hold of ajnanam, he cannot escape from those karmas. Karma, which are in the form of a karma pala. Karma means karma pala, which the person has acquired over a period of time. A jiva is in general, it is bound in two ways. That is not knowing one's essential nature, one's swarupa. It is taking oneself to be this body, mind, sense complex. Taking anatma to be atma. It is the main cause of samsara. Ajnanam is the bandhakaranam. In the wake of jnanam, ajnanam, which is in the form of taking anatma to be atma or vice versa, it goes away. This is one type of bandha and bandha nivritti. And because of ajnanam only, a jiva becomes a karta, a bhokta. Because he considers himself a karta and therefore he has to reap the results of action as a bhokta. And in the wake of jnanam, what happens? Jnanam, which is in the form of taking atma to be karta bhokta, that also goes away and therefore it becomes free. Atma being a karta and a bhokta, in the wake of jnanam, it becomes free. But the same atma becomes limited when the person thinks himself to be a karta and a bhokta. Being a karta, therefore, a jiva is bound by karma. And when he is a karta, he cannot avoid being a bhokta. Therefore, taking oneself to be a karta and therefore becoming a bhokta, a jiva cannot avoid. But there is a certain idea among some people that they think the conclusion is, if you exhaust all your karmas, karmas means the karmas which you have accumulated from the countless janma, if you exhaust all the karma, then you will become free. This is some type of conclusion some people have. But the karmas are limitless. The karmas what you have accumulated, they are limitless. And to reap the karma pala of all the karmas which you have done in the countless janma, and also you keep increasing in karma in the present life, how can you become free from karma? How can you exhaust all the karma? You cannot become free from karma because of countless karma done in countless janma. Therefore, the idea that you become free once you exhaust all your karma, that will not work. Your janma is anadi, that is beginningless. And from the beginningless janma, you have been doing karma. We don't know what karma will fructify when. Even in our current janma, we don't know what karma will come when. A lot of karmas are yet to be fructified. And therefore, exhaustion of all karmas lead to freedom. It is not a good proposition. To exhaust all karmas, you need countless janmas. And in all the countless janmas, that is the future janma, you will be doing karma, which also will produce karma pala, again which you have to experience. So you have to take janma again and again to reap those karmas. Therefore, it is a cycle. So you cannot get out of this cycle just being a karta, just being a bhokta. Therefore, karma vidya moksha, that is freedom from karma, it is not possible. Then how is it possible? You can remove only the basic ignorance. Only ajnanam can be removed by knowing that aham atma. Once you know that you are atma, then you cannot become karta. And therefore you cannot become bhokta. Atma is akarta. Atma is abhokta. Therefore, once you know that you are atma, the kartrutvam bhoktrutvam is as well removed. They go away in the wake of jnanam. Therefore, karma bandha nirmuktaha syat. Without doing anything really, no action on your part, you remove all the karmas which you have done from, which you have accumulated from the beginningless janma. Therefore, with the jnanam, ajnanam as well as the products of ajnanam, they disappear, they go away. Disappears means goes away. It is something like a dreamer, a swapna purusha, who performs a varieties of action in the dream. He performs a lot of action, varieties of action, both right action and good action in the dream. It is a swapna. And when the person wakes up, the dreamer is falsified. The dreamer is negated. The dreamer, who is nothing but a projection on the part of the waker, is negated. When the waker is up, when the waker gets up, dreamer is negated. He is falsified. When the dreamer is falsified, all the karmas done by the dreamer, along with its karmapala, they are also falsified. Now, who is accountable for the action done by the dreamer? Not the waker. You cannot hold waker to be responsible for the action done by the dreamer. Waker is not accountable for the dreamer's action. And therefore, the waker need not undergo the karmapala of the Swapna Purusha. Dreamer is falsified when the waker is up. Even though, really speaking, the dreamer is not totally different from the waker, the dreamer is falsified. We don't really say dreamer's actions are falsified. We say the dreamer himself is falsified. When the dreamer himself is falsified, then what happened to the dreamer's action? They also become falsified. That is what we call karma vinir mokshaha. He becomes free from the hold of karmas. So when the waker is up, dreamer is falsified. When the dreamer is the adhara for all the karma and the karma pala, what will happen to that? It also becomes falsified. So we don't say that karma will go. What will happen when the kartrutam and bhoktrutam goes away? That which is responsible for this vicious karma cycle, then the person becomes free. When ajnanam is gone, all the karmas which are waiting in line, in queue, to give its result, karma pala, it also goes away. So when the ignorance is gone, karmas also are gone. And therefore, it becomes karma vinir muktaha. But still, why should we say karma vinir muktaha? When the ignorance goes away, when ajnanam goes away, ajnanam karyam also goes away. That is, you can understand. Then why should we say karma vinir muktaha? Why? Because in Shastram, that karma here means karma pala. The karma phala vinir muktaha. Karma pala is considered to be ritam. It is satyam. In Shastram, karma pala is considered to be satyam. It is called satyam. Why? Because avashyam bhavitvat. Karma pala, that is definitely subject to fructification, which will definitely give the result. That is why it is called satyam. The result of karma, which will give the. Can you hear me? Somebody said.
Now only konja neram voice kekla, or 2 minutes onnume illa voice ipo da varudhu.
Okay, it was paused. Anyway, we will miss it in between.
And that's what I was trying to tell you. It came the yellow color, so I was wondering. Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I stop it for some time. Fine. Tadetat satyam. That is, Mandakopanishad says, that satyam. What satyam? That is the rituals which the rishis, they saw. The form of Vedic mantras, they are all satyam, they are true. And this is what it is explained in Tretayam Bhavada Santatani, in many ways in Rig Veda, Yajur Veda and Samaveda. Therefore, Tani Acharata Niyatam, may you perform them regularly. O Satyakama, Satyakama is, O the seekers of Karmapala, you do it regularly. Yesham of Panta Suprutasya Loke. For you, this alone is a means of gaining the results of action. This is the statement of the Mundaka Upanishad. So here it says, karma phala is satyam. Even the same idea it is there in Katha Upanishad. Ritam pibanto sukrutasya loke ukham pravishto parame pararthe chaya tapo brahma vidho vadanti panchaknayo ye chatrinachi ketaha. Here also ritam. The ritam means the result of action, result of right action and wrong action. So karma palam is ritam, satyam. For every karma, there will be a palam. Karma palam will be there. And that karma palam is going to be in the form of experience, for which you require a upadhi, in the form of body, mind, sense complex. Because you did karma and you have to experience the karma pala, and for that you need upadhi. And that karma palam in the form of punarapi jananam, that cannot be avoided. Karma palam, the form of another janma, it cannot be avoided. Because if karma palam is there, then it should be experienced. Na buktam kshiyate karma kalpa koti shatairati. Karma which were not experienced, it will not get destroyed on its own. Even in the hundreds and crores of kalpa, the karma will not get destroyed. You have done the karma, therefore you have to reap the benefit of karma. Benefit means you have to enjoy the experience of karma, undergo the experience of karma pala, that you cannot escape. It means the karma palam will not get destroyed. It means that wherever you are, the karma palam will find you and make you experience it, whether it is pleasurable or otherwise. In fact, there is no freedom from karma even by prayashita karma. People say by being prayashita, one become free. What really you do is, you can neutralize the result of a wrong action by doing another karma. You are doing another karma to destroy the karma pala of another action. Doing another karma, it is not destruction of karma. It is again, it is doing an action to offset an unwanted karma pala. The result being unwanted, you perform another action to remove that result. So it is a sort of a corrective action. Therefore, it is not a cancer. Cancelling the action, you cannot cancel it. Therefore, the past actions cannot be cancelled. So, ritam means satyam, truth, which is avashyam bhavi. It is since the karma, it is going to be reaped by you, you cannot avoid it. So, it is always there. If it is always there, then how can you avoid? So, how can you destroy all the karmas which you have gathered without experiencing it? Therefore, what they say is, they say there is no moksha from karma, but there is moksha from being a karta. We are not really getting ourselves freed from karma. We are getting freed ourselves from kartritvam and therefore bhoktritvam. Because Atma is not the karta. Atma is not the doer. All that was done by the doer with the notion, I am the doer, agam karta. Now, in the wake of jnanam, what happened to that? They become nothing. They are declared null, void. And therefore, nobody is there to claim that karma pala. And that is what is referred here as karma bandha vinir muktaha. And therefore, you don't have to do anything for karma nasha after jnanam. By aparoksha jnanam, agam brahma, karma goes away. And therefore, you don't require anything else in between. You don't require to do anything. Agam brahma means agam na karta, agam na bhokta. And that's all. And that knowledge does the job. And nikila karma bandha nirmuktah syat. Nikila means, akila means all. Akira means all karmas. All karmas, the karmas which are many and varied karmas. That is what Nikila is. Nothing is left over. Nikila means all, everything. And there are varieties of karmas. Varieties of karma we have done. And the nature of karma is like that. The karmas are many and varied. And therefore, they are not, the experience of karma pala, they are not going to be the same. Because the karmas are vary and minute, and therefore karma palas also will be various and they will be different. and therefore you need different types of bodies to require different types of karma phalam. For example, what karma you can exhaust by being born in India, that you cannot do by taking birth in another country. And what, which period of time and to which parent you are born, all these are taken into account only by karma. If one's karma phala is such that one has to eat always, then one has to take a special body for that. He has to incarnate as Varaha Avatara. So that is how the karma works. And this combinations of different karma and how they express, it is really, if you see, it's amazing. It's a big network done by Bhagavan, Ishvara. Therefore, it is Gaganagatihi. It is inscrutable. The karmas are many and varied, and accordingly, it gives the karma phala, and what karma phala will manifest at what time, it is inscrutable. They are Gaganagatihi. But now, after this, the author is going to point out the different type of karma from the standpoint of the nature of karma in terms of fructification. How does it fructify? We have seen in the wake of jnanam, ajnanam goes away, and all the products of ajnanam, ajnana karyam also goes away. Therefore, the being Atma, the Jivan Mukta becomes free from Kartrutvam and Bhoktrutvam, and therefore no karma can touch him. But Jivan Mukta, he has to live for the rest of his life. And there is no Punarjanma for him, because he has no more Kartrutvam. As I gave the example of the dreamer is falsified, dreamer's action also falsified. And similarly here, when the Jivan Mukta, he becomes free from Kartrutvam and also from Bhoktrutvam, then what happened to the karmas, what he has accumulated over a period of time, and also the karmas are many and varied, different types of karma, how it is going to fructify, and that is what the author is going to describe. The author is going to point to the different type of karma from the standpoint of the karma phala. That is what the author is going to describe. We will see it in the next class. So the next class, the topic will be karma, that is karmani, karma phalani. The three types of karma phala in general, and how does it connect with the Jivan Mukta. When the Jivan Mukta becomes free from all the karma, then what is the relationship of these three karma with regard to a Jivan Mukta? And the process, we will also understand the connection with regard to a Jiva. So that we will see in the next. ॐ पूर्णमदः पूर्णमिदं पूर्णात् पूर्णमुदच्यते पूर्णस्य पूर्णमादाय पूर्णमेवावशिष्यते ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः हरिः ॐ श्रीगुरुभ्यो नमः हरिः ॐ
धन्यवादः Shanji, did you see my messages?
Yeah, I saw them. Yeah.
Okay.